And so we read this psalm for our Old Testament reading. I would invite you to stand for the reading of God's word, Psalm chapter 16. A miktam of David, preserve me, O God, for in you I put my trust. O my soul, you have said to the Lord, you are my Lord. My goodness is nothing apart from you. As for the saints who are on the earth, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight. Their sorrows shall be multiplied, who hasten after another God. Their drink offerings of blood I will not offer, nor take up their names on my lips. O Lord, you are the portion of my inheritance and my cup. You maintain my lot. The lines have fallen to me in pleasant places. Yes, I have a good inheritance. I will bless the Lord who has given me counsel. My heart also instructs me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my glory rejoices. My flesh also will rest in hope, for you will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Our New Testament reading, Acts chapter 2, starting with verse 14. We'll read through verse 41 as we look at the sermon that Peter preached. Starting with Acts 2 and verse 14. But Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, "Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words, for these are not drunk, as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day, but this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. And on my men servants and on my maid servants, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. And it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know, him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you have taken by lawless hands, have crucified and put to death, whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible that he should be held by it. For David says concerning him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for he is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore, my heart rejoiced and my tongue was glad. Moreover, my flesh also will rest in hope, for you will not leave my soul in Hades, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of joy in your presence. Men and brethren, let me speak freely to you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his body, according to the flesh, he would raise up the Christ to sit on his throne, he, foreseeing this, spoke concerning the resurrection of the Christ, that his soul was not left in Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God has raised up, of which we are all witnesses. Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this which you now see and hear. For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he says himself, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. Amen. You may be seated. We continue our focus on what we might say is the greatest event in church history after the ascension of Jesus Christ, the day of Pentecost, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, as we see about 3,000 men and women were converted, they were baptized, they were added to the church. They were added to them, verse 41 declares. Now we know there have been many other crusades in the last 1,987 years. Some of them are manufactured by human wisdom. Some of them we can say are truly spirit-blessed. But even if we don't just count numbers, we can say this is the most significant day we can say in church history after the ascension, the coming of the Holy Spirit and the spread of the gospel beginning in Jerusalem. So as we read this chapter, as we reflect on it, one of the things we must do is give thanks and praise. We still look back, we give God thanks and praise for the day of Pentecost. And we also then pray that we will faithfully stand on God's word as we seek to proclaim the same message of the gospel without compromise. This is a long text, and so first I want to do an overview of Peter's sermon, and then second, stressing some of the key points that Peter raises, some of the theological points that we can see from this message. But first, let's give attention to Peter's sermon. In our English translations, it's about 580 words. If you count carefully, about 580 words. We would guess that Peter spoke much longer than just 580 words. I don't think this was a 5 or a 6 minute sermon. In fact, Luke tells us this is only a portion of what Peter said. We have a portion, we have an inspired summary of this sermon. And so that's what we must deal with. We must deal with this inspired summary. There are about 6 parts to this summary, as we see an introduction in verses 14 and 15, and also Peter's first point. The first point of his sermon is the easiest point maybe to make. We are not drunk. Point one, we are not drunk. It's only 9 a.m. A day in Roman timing started at 6 a.m. Peter says, this is only the third day. We have not been drinking. We are not drunk. That's point number one. Second, then Peter turns to the Old Testament, and you see 3 Old Testament passages, along with many other allusions in this sermon. It's a very Old Testament-centered message. What else would we expect? The first passage is from Joel 2, 28 and 32 in our English translations. So Peter, his second point is, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. What is taking place was prophesied by Joel. Now, what did Joel prophesy? His prophecy is that it will come to pass in the last days. Well, the last days have come with Christ. In the last days, God would pour out his Spirit on all flesh. That is, all kinds of people, not just restricted in the Old Testament, we might say, to prophets and priests and kings. They were the ones who were anointed. They were to be filled with the Spirit. Many of them were not truly filled. They were maybe given oil. But God would do a much greater work among all kinds of people, men servants and maid servants. He would pour out his Spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. Now, part of that fulfillment was this day of Pentecost. We've noted the 120 who were given the ability to speak in other languages. Now, they were speaking praises to God. They were not giving sermons. But verse 4, we noted there is a particular word in verse 4 translated as utterance. It is, we might say, special speech, loud speech that was being spoken by the 120, and that is connected with Joel, who says they shall prophesy. I don't think we have to restrict the fulfillment of this to just the day of Pentecost. There would be others that the Lord would so call. In fact, you read of both men and women who were given the special gift in that season of prophecy, the ability through the Holy Spirit to set forth God's word in a very special way. Now, there are some difficult parts also to Joel's prophecy, aren't there? We read in verses 19 and 20, the sun being turned to darkness, the moon into blood. And Joel says, this will happen before the awesome day of the Lord comes about, before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. And here, as we study this, we're also, I think, to consider fulfillment of this in the life, specifically the death of Jesus. That there would be other signs that would continue, not just on the day of Pentecost, but other signs that would continue until that awesome day of the Lord, which I believe we can see came in the judgment around AD 70. Now look again at Joel's words. Again, there's some difficulty here, but we know that when Jesus was crucified, there was a supernatural darkness. That was not just a normal or a natural thing. No, there was supernatural darkness. For 3 hours, we're told that lasted. Also, some have suggested the moon, and it was a full moon at the time of the crucifixion, was a blood moon, that it looked like it turned red for a time. Some have suggested that is perhaps what Joel is saying. So the Lord did give signs, supernatural and we might say more natural signs, to show what? To show the significance of the death of Christ, to show that he was made our sacrifice, that God's wrath was being poured out on him as he bore our sins. And we have a record that the Lord continued to show signs to Israel. He showed them supernatural signs. The pouring forth of the Holy Spirit was one of them. And what is the point of all of this? The point is to call Israel to repentance. Now was the time for repentance. And most importantly, then, Joel ends here. Peter quotes in verse 21, it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So Peter takes this prophecy from Joel to show what is taking place, to explain what is taking place on the day of Pentecost. But then the rest of Peter's sermon, the point is this. He goes on to show the fulfillment of verse 21 in the person and work of Jesus Christ. That's the point then of this sermon. He begins with Joel. Joel ends in verse 21 with this particular point, and Peter now seeks to prove verse 21 is fulfilled in the person and work of Jesus Christ. All that has taken place in the life of Jesus shows he is Messiah and Lord. And so as you start in verse 22, as you go to the climax of the sermon, which I would say is verse 36, Peter is making a point. Verse 21 is fulfilled in the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, we only have an overview, a summary. Let's look briefly at this overview that Peter provides. Peter speaks of the ministry of Jesus, that it also was attested by miracles, wonders, and signs. Now, people try to deny those signs. Sometimes they said Jesus is filled by Satan. That's why he's able to cast out demons. Peter points there was objective proofs for what Jesus did. But notice, at least in our text, that's not where Peter dwells. He doesn't deny those things. He goes on to speak then of the absolute necessity of the death of Christ. Jesus had to die. Look again at verse 23 carefully. He is delivered, notice, by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God. Isn't that interesting? He is delivered by God. And then you have taken by lawless hands, the Jews through the Romans, the lawless hands, you have crucified and have put him to death. Now, we studied verse 23 when we looked at the doctrine of God's sovereignty. And this is a very important verse, isn't it? To explain that God is sovereign and yet men are responsible. We cannot explain all of the mystery of that. Verse 23 cannot be denied. The determined purpose, the foreknowledge of God. And foreknowledge doesn't mean, well, God looked to see what would happen. It means God knew what would happen. The determined purpose of God, that is God's eternal plan. And yet you are responsible. You have taken by lawless hands. You have crucified. You have put him to death. Again, we cannot fully explain how God's sovereignty and man's responsibility fit together, but they are not in any way in contradiction. And verse 23, there are other verses, but verse 23 is a very important verse. And then look with me at verse 24. What a beautiful description of the resurrection. God raised up Jesus, and yet it was not possible that Jesus should be held by death. Isn't that such a beautiful harmony of the triune work of God? Jesus cannot be held by death. The Father has raised up Jesus. A beautiful testimony to the resurrection. And then Peter, to prove this point, says this is what David was speaking about. David was speaking about the resurrection. Psalm 16. And again, we see the beautiful unity of Scripture. Throughout Peter's sermon, we'll focus more on that later. Now, how could Peter prove that Psalm 16 speaks of Christ? Now, if you read Psalm 16, you may not immediately reach that conclusion. Again, this is one of the points that we have to make. We have to be guided in our interpretation by the apostles. The apostles set forth how we interpret. But how does Peter prove that Psalm 16 speaks of Christ? Well, one of the proofs is this. The tomb of David is with us. Psalm 16 speaks of life, of rescue from the grave, and yet Peter could say, and we don't know if he could see the very tomb of David from where he was preaching, but he could tell everybody, you can find the tomb of David. David is dead. He is still buried. So Psalm 16 cannot just be speaking about David himself. It must be speaking of Christ. And Peter gives two additional points. First, David was a prophet, verse 30. Being a prophet, that is, he is able to speak about things that go way beyond just ordinary understanding, ordinary interpretation. He can speak of the Messiah. And then, second, David was given a promise. David was given a promise that God would place one of his descendants, he would bring from his line the Messiah, the Christ, to sit on his throne. And so Peter says this necessitates the resurrection. This is why Psalm 16 ultimately speaks of Christ. David is a prophet. David is dead, but his son has ascended to the throne. Then Peter moves on to speak of the ascension. And then look at the end of verse 33. We see Pentecost. We often speak of Pentecost as the coming of the Holy Spirit. That is true. But notice how Peter describes the day of Pentecost. Jesus, having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this, which you now see and hear. When God works, it's always the triune working of God. So yes, we speak of Pentecost. It is the coming of the Holy Spirit. That's one aspect. But I love this description, verse 33. Jesus has received the promise from the Father, which has now been poured out. Now, to prove this, Peter quotes Psalm 110. Peter quotes Psalm 110 to show David did not ascend into heaven. No, David is still buried. He has not been raised from the grave. I think we can probably say Psalm 110 is the most important psalm that's used in the New Testament, in the fact that it's quoted most often. How does Peter use this psalm? He uses it to make the same point that Christ did. That when David is speaking in this psalm, he is speaking about God as triune. The Lord Yahweh said to my Lord Adonai. Yahweh said to my Lord. David was not the one who is the referent in this psalm. No, David is speaking of Christ. Then verse 36, I think we can say, is the climax of this sermon. Peter, now based on the events of Pentecost, based on the ministry, based on the death, the burial, the resurrection, the ascension of Jesus, it is clear that verse 21 is fulfilled in the Lord Jesus Christ. Look again at verse 36. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Now, the verb made maybe troubles you when you first read it. I mean, Jesus is made Messiah. He is made Lord. Well, that verb means it is proven, it is revealed, it is clear that Jesus is the promised Messiah. He was that from eternity, but it has been made clear by all of these events, including what was taking place that day, that Jesus is Lord. Now look at verse 37. The response is conviction of sin. They were cut to the heart. Many who heard him were cut to the heart. They were convicted of their sin, and they asked the question, what do we need to do? And the response is very significant. Now, we are familiar, I trust, with this passage. We read it. It makes sense to us. But again, think in terms of the whole temple sacrificial system. Peter doesn't say, go offer a sacrifice. You're at the temple, in fact. Go take an animal and offer it as payment for your sin. Now, that's not at all what Peter says. He tells them, repent, turn. The same language that Christ used. Repent, let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you also you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, we're going to look at this again in just a moment in our passage, but does Peter speak of faith? Does he speak of belief? And the answer is yes. It's just not expressed that way in our translations. In no way is Peter saying, as long as you go through the outer ritual of baptism, all your sins somehow are washed away mystically. Why would Peter preach a sermon if all you had to do was just be baptized? Interesting, Luke in chapter 7 and verse 30 of his gospel makes this note. I believe it's only found in Luke, but we read this. But the Pharisees and lawyers rejected the will of God for themselves, not having been baptized by him, that is by John. Baptism, and we'll note this later, baptism was for pagans. Baptism was for the nations, not for Jews. And so many of the Pharisees and the lawyers, they had nothing to do with John's baptism. So when Peter calls for them to be baptized, that's not just an outer act. It is expressing conviction of sin. It is expressing trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so especially then for these early Jews, baptism was an expression. They were trusting in Jesus Christ. In verse 39, Peter emphasizes the mercy and still the covenant faithfulness of God. The promises to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, that is, the nations. There is, I believe, continuity in terms of the Old Testament promises, the Old Testament explanation. We do believe in the doctrine of covenant. But notice, Peter ends with, as many as the Lord our God will call. Salvation is not some automatic ritual. It's dependent entirely on the sovereign work of God. As many as the Lord our God will call. And on that day, as verse 41 indicates, the response was very great. 3,000 souls, about 3,000 souls were baptized. They were added to them. They become part of the true church, the true Israel that God was building. Well, secondly, I want to reflect on just four points from Peter's sermon, just stepping back a greater degree and reflecting on it. First, we see very clearly the connection of Scripture and historical truth. The connection of Scripture, the Old Testament, and historical truth. This entire sermon is based on the combination of the fulfillment of Scripture and real historical events, we can say. Going back to David and others who made these prophecies. Now, you know there has been a long-standing assault on Scripture. Whether that's in the 20th century, the 19th century, the 18th century, you could go back hundreds of years, you know the assault on Scripture. And it seems that Satan always changes that assault in various ways. And today, I think many, they have substituted truth with vague forms of love and feeling. They downplay the significance of truth. That's somewhat controversial. And so what's more important is love and feeling. Others have suggested, well, we don't really know what we can be confident in. We'll just approach the Word of God with doubt and questions. That is what we'll celebrate. We'll celebrate doubt. We'll celebrate the questions we have. And we all just get together. We're not really sure, but as long as we love each other, all will be well. And you see these things. They are taught. I'm not exaggerating. So what we see so clearly, again, following the apostles, not that we become arrogant, but we follow the example of the apostles. We have a full confidence in Scripture. That is the testimony of the apostles, full confidence in the truth of Scripture. And then connected with this, we see how Scripture has a focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. And Peter is not making something up. This is not some technique that Peter has determined to make sense. No, Peter shows us the focus of all of Scripture is on Christ. How? Well, the explanation, this is the result of the Holy Spirit guiding all the writing of Scripture. This is the result of God preparing the way for the coming of Christ. Now, it's good to go through each of the texts that Peter has mentioned. We've only skimmed them. But we can say all of Scripture has a focus on Christ. A second related point is how Peter focuses on the good news of the gospel, that is the life, death, burial, resurrection, the exaltation of Christ. And there would be no Christian faith without this. All of Scripture depends on the historic truth related to the Lord Jesus Christ. Look again at verse 36. I think in some sense we could say this. Verse 36 is the central truth of all of Scripture. Not that it's the only thing we need to know in our Bibles. I think we can say all of Scripture focuses on this. Let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. That, I think we can say, that is the great central theme of the entire Word of God. Third, we see illustrated again the only way of salvation. Again, we go back to verse 21, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. And then verse 38 speaks of the need to repent. That is, to turn from something and to turn unto something else, to turn from sin, to turn unto the Lord Jesus Christ. And then Peter stressed, as we noted, he stressed that those who turned would be baptized, to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Now, we know that cults and false churches have twisted the words of Peter here. We don't need to go into all the details. Many have not properly understood the doctrine of salvation, and so they take a verse like this and they twist it and they use it for their own purposes. We have to step back and consider not just an individual verse, like verse 38 or another verse, but the whole picture that the New Testament presents. And we see in Scripture that a sinner must be regenerated. A sinner has to be given new life, regenerated by the Holy Spirit. And that regeneration, Scripture says, takes part from any work that a sinner can do. Men and women are dead in sin. What works can dead people do? What works can a dead man do? And the answer is nothing. So a sinner is first regenerated, given life, and part of the evidence then of regeneration, we can say, is conviction of sin. That's what we see in verse 37. They are cut to the heart. They are convicted of their sin. We can say this is an aspect of repentance. A sinner is given new life to now realize the horror of sin, to see that it is an offense against a holy God, to see the horror of sin in the light of the necessity of Jesus Christ suffering the punishment that you deserve to bear. And when someone is regenerated, what also then do they seek? They seek the only way of salvation that is found in Jesus Christ. And since Jesus commanded what at the end of Matthew 28? He commanded that all disciples be baptized. That was the instruction of Jesus. We can see Peter is following the word of Christ that those who do respond, those who have been cut to the heart, they are now wanting to call on the name of the Lord. And so, yes, they are then baptized that very day. Craig Keener, who is the author of a New Testament background commentary, notes this. Because baptism was a sign of conversion to Judaism, normally reserved for pagans, Peter's demand would offend his Jewish hearers and cost them respectability. He calls for a public, radical testimony of conversion, not a private, non-committal request for salvation with no conditions, in the name of Jesus Christ. Distinguishes this sort of baptism requiring faith in Christ from other ancient baptisms. This phrase simply means the person being baptized confesses Christ. So Peter is calling for these Jewish listeners to do something that would have put them at odds, would have cost them, we can say, their respectability. So yes, they are not saved by their baptism. Their baptism is part of their profession of faith in Christ. It is a reminder that Christ indeed washes away sin. Now, in this congregation, we do baptize infants, those who are born into families where there is at least one believing parent. We believe that is proper. And children, if you have been baptized maybe when you were very little, this passage also does speak to you. Have you been brought to a place of confession of the Lord Jesus Christ? Has God worked in your heart so you have confessed indeed that you are a sinner, that you know the only way of salvation? And then secondly, if you have a testimony a faith in Christ? Have you been baptized? Maybe that has come later, you've come from another congregation. If you have a testimony of faith in Christ, have you received the sign and seal of baptism? As wicked as it is that there are cults and false churches that twist the message, there are others who, I think, delay the importance of baptism. These people who responded were baptized on that very day. Now, that was not always the case in church history. Sometimes there was a process of instruction, of catechism. There's different reasons, we could say good and bad for that. But clearly, if you have a profession of faith in Jesus Christ and you have not been baptized, don't delay in seeking to receive the sign and seal which Jesus Christ commands. We would not want to diminish that which Christ has commanded. Fourth and finally here, let's consider the tremendous fruit that came from Peter's preaching. And some have questioned the number here. 3,000 people? Are you serious? 3,000 people responded and were baptized that day? Well, several points should be stated as we reflect on this vast number. And first, we've commented on this already several times. During the feast, Jerusalem, which was a small city, Jerusalem maybe, I don't know if it's 20, 30,000 people it had normally, but during the feasts, the population would swell enormously. Hundreds of thousands of people would try to fit into this tiny city. Remember, it only has about 2 miles in circumference. So not everyone could always stay in Jerusalem. Sometimes they would stay in nearby cities as they came to the feasts. Secondly, Herod's temple, we know, is this massive complex. It's at least as large as our entire property here. So literally thousands of people would have been in the area of the temple and in the morning at about 9 a.m. And so thousands of people could have heard and did hear Peter preach. Second, related to this, we have many examples in history, those like George Whitefield, even the Wesleys, who were able to preach outside without any amplification to thousands of people. Now, there is in Whitefield journals, at times he reported massive, massive crowds. Some have said those are maybe a little exaggerated. And even later in his life, Whitefield adjusted some of those. But Benjamin Franklin did a famous calculation listening to George Whitefield of how many people Whitefield could reach just with his voice in the open air. And he concluded thousands and thousands of people. And other researchers have done studies and the estimates of 20 to 30,000 people hearing someone like George Whitefield preach is not an exaggeration. It's amazing. Not everyone could do that, of course, but there is record of that. Now, verse 14, look again at verse 14. It's interesting. Peter is the one who preaches, but he stands up with the 11. All the apostles stand as witnesses of what Peter is about to proclaim. Peter raised his voice, and we noted the verb said, used in verse 14. It's translated just sort of this ordinary verb of speech. But if you look in a Greek lexicon, that verse emphasizes sound, loudness of sound, rather than just content. So Peter would have had to project his voice. This is an amazing exercise in preaching to a massive crowd. And again, what makes this all the more wonderful, this was not an organized revival meeting. This was a spontaneous, Spirit-led meeting where people throng to hear him. As they heard the mighty sounds, as they heard people speaking in other tongues, it did cause a large crowd to gather. And so, yes, God did give incredible fruit in some of that early gospel preaching. But as you study the rest of Acts, it does not say, well, every time the apostles preached, thousands of people were always reached and saved. No, sometimes the response was anger, and those who preached were put to death. And so, yes, we look back on Pentecost and we say, oh, I would love to see thousands of people saved every time. But attempts to duplicate that, to try to manipulate that, have a long, sad, dangerous history in our nation and many other places. Manipulation, the attempts of men, and into places that we don't want to go. A.W. Tozer said this, "I do not believe in a repetition of Pentecost, but I do believe in a perpetuation of Pentecost." There's a vast difference between the two. And John Murray stated, "If Pentecost is not repeated, neither is it retracted. This is the era of the Holy Spirit." Amen. We live in the era of the Holy Spirit. We must stand on truth. We must focus on the Lord Jesus Christ, the only way of salvation. That's the heart. And Lord, give us a desire to see many reached with the truth. But we must trust in God and His sovereign power. We cannot resort to manipulation or techniques. It must be a faithful communication, a sharing of the truth. Do you often pray for the salvation of the lost? Do you pray for the advancement of the gospel? Do you pray for the faithful preaching of the gospel here and in other places? Pray to that end for the glory of our great God. And let us now pray. Heavenly Father, we do praise you for the day of Pentecost, for the mighty moving of the Holy Spirit, the work that you did through the 11 apostles and through the others that were gathered on that great day. And we also want to faithfully stand on your truth. And we pray indeed that you will give us a burden to see many others reached with the message of the gospel, reached with the full truth of your word. We want to see disciples. And so, Lord, let us grow also in our own maturity and focus upon you to live as you have called us. Lord, we know we fail you in many ways. So we do not look within, but we seek to pray and to be confident that your truth will prevail even in this age of great deception and confusion. For the glory of your name, for the advancement of our Lord and Savior's kingdom, we pray. In Jesus' great name, amen.